Hello students, in our previous session of the chapter number 2, that is systematics of living organisms, we have learned regarding the different types of fungi from kingdom fungi. In this session we are going to learn about the fifth kingdom. In the five kingdom system of classification proposed by the scientist, that is R.H. Whittaker. So we are going to learn regarding the kingdom Animalia and about acellular organisms. Now acellular organisms are those which do not show presence of well organized cell structure, as well as membrane bound cell organelles are also absent in them. So in this session we are going to learn regarding kingdom Animalia and acellular organisms. The fifth kingdom in the system of classification, that is five kingdom system of classification, is kingdom Animalia. Now kingdom Animalia include all the animals. Now animals in the kingdom Animalia are showing heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Now you know that heterotrophic mode of nutrition means the organisms are dependent on other organisms for their food material or nutrition. So animals show the holozoic mode of nutrition, that is it is a type of heterotrophic mode of nutrition. They show holozoic mode of nutrition. Now holozoic mode of nutrition means they ingest or they take food material in the form of liquid or solid through the mouth. Hence the mode of nutrition is called as holozoic mode of nutrition. Then this food material is later on converted into small particulate matter or into more simple form, and then energy is obtained by animals. Then you know that the unique feature of animals is that they have the capacity of locomotion. That means they can move from one place to another place. This is the unique characteristic feature in the animals. Then the animals are having multicellular, or they are multicellular eukaryotes. That means they show presence of eukaryotic cell structure. You know that eukaryotic cell shows presence of well-developed nucleus, then membrane-bound cell organelles like Golgi complex, mitochondria, then endoplasmic reticulum are present. Hence, they are included, or they show presence of eukaryotic cell structure. Then cells show absence of chlorophyll. So you know that chlorophyll is essential for the process of photosynthesis, with the help of which plants can produce their own food material. But in animals, as chlorophyll is absent, they are dependent on other organisms for their food material. Then they show absence of cell wall. So in animals, cell wall is absent. Then the growth in animals is determinate, that is it follows definite pattern. So in animal the growth has a definite pattern. So all animals show definite growth pattern. Then there are different types of organisms found on the earth, from which each organism or each species has different characteristics. So kingdom Animalia or the animals are of different varieties. There are many species of animals, and these animals have vast diversity in their structure, then in their color, then height, then nutrition habits. So there is a vast difference between these animals. Then animals may live in water. That means some animals are aquatic like fish, then some animals are terrestrial, then they are found in different regions, that is low temperature region, high temperature region. So there is a vast variety of animals found on earth. Now the next topic is acellular organisms. Now acellular organisms are those which show absence of different types of cell organelles, like mitochondria, then a Golgi complex, then endoplasmic reticulum, and they do not have definite cell structure. Hence they are called as acellular organisms. Now there are three types of acellular organisms which we are going to study. The first one is virus or viruses, the second one is viroids, and the third one are lichens. So first of all, we are going to learn regarding the acellular organisms, that is viruses. Now viruses, you are all known to different types of viruses. So now at present we are facing the situation of the pandemic due to the virus, that is COVID-19. So these viruses are highly poisonous. Hence the viruses were named by Louis Pasteur, considering the meaning, that is venom or poison. So these viruses are poisonous, means they cause diseases in living organisms, and sometimes due to this disease the plant or organism may even die. Hence they are termed as venomic or poisonous in nature. Then these are obligate parasites. Now obligate parasite means they cannot multiply outside the body of the host cell. That means when these viruses enter the body of a suitable host, it may be plant or it may be animal, then only they multiply and reproduce. Hence they are called as obligate parasite and were given the name virus by the scientist called as M.J. Bezerink, after the observation that they were able to migrate in agar gel. Now agar is a type of substance which is used to produce different types of nutrient mediums, and these nutrient mediums are used in laboratory experiments. So these viruses can migrate in agar gel. So this agar gel is produced by the substance called as agar agar, and this agar gel or agar is used as a nutrient medium to grow different types of organisms in laboratory condition. So these viruses were able to migrate through this agar gel. Then viruses being an infectious soluble agent, that means viruses are infectious, that means they cause infection in different living organisms, and they are soluble in different types of substances. He called the filtrate as contagium vivum fluidum. That means contagium means the viruses can spread through the contact of organism, hence they are called as contagious. Then vivum means virus, and these virus fluid or viruses are different soluble agents and they are spread through contact. Hence the scientist called it as contagium vivum fluidum. Then the scientist Stanley demonstrated that viruses are inert outside the host cell. Now inert means they remain as it is outside the host, and they cannot reproduce outside the host. Host means the organisms which is infected by the viruses. It may be plant or it may be animal. So the viruses cannot reproduce outside the body of the host cell. Hence, they are called as inert, and they are generally present in crystallized form, or they are present generally in crystallized form. Here we can see an example of virus. Now, virus shows generally protective layer, that is made up of protein and which is covered by a envelope. Then inside the protein coat, here is the protein coat. So inside the protein coat, there may be genetic material, or this genetic material may be DNA or it may be RNA. In some viruses, DNA is genetic material, while in some viruses, RNA is the genetic material. So outside the host, the viruses are inert and they are generally in crystallized form. Similarly, viruses are made up of proteins. Now, viruses lack their own cell machinery. That means they show absence of different cell organelles, and hence the process of metabolism does not occur in the viruses. Then viruses have protein coat. Here we can see the structure of coronavirus. Now this coronavirus causes respiratory diseases, and at present we see that it has become a pandemic. That means infection has spread all over the world. Then this coronavirus is made up of, or generally all the viruses are made up of protein coat, or it is called as capsid, around the nucleic acid strand, and hence considered to be acellular organisms. So here we can see it is the protein coat of coronavirus, and it consists of membrane and envelope. So this protein or the envelope or the cover of the coronavirus, that is protective covering, consists of proteins and lipids. And these viruses are inactive outside the host cell. But once when they enter the host cell, they become active and take charge of the cellular machinery of the host cell and duplicate themselves. So here we can see that this coronavirus shows presence of a single-stranded nucleic acid, or it is called as RNA. So this single-stranded nucleic acid or RNA is present, and it is associated with proteins called as nucleocapsid. Then it shows presence of spikes. With the help of these spikes, it is attached to the cell surface. So when the coronavirus enters through the respiratory system into the lungs, or enters inside the respiratory system, inside the lungs, then it starts the process of infection. And generally the viruses are specific to specific host. That means some viruses cause diseases in bacteria, then some viruses cause disease in plants, while some cause diseases in animals. So here we can see, for example, here is the cell of human being. Now at the center, you all know that nucleus is present. Then inside the nucleus, chromosomes or DNA is present. So what happens when this virus, when comes in contact with this cell? So this virus will come in contact with the human cell, and it will inject its genetic material, that is RNA, inside the host cell, and then this RNA will get incorporated, or it will get attached to the DNA of this host cell. That means carry the process of replication and it will change the characteristics of the host DNA. So the viral RNA or the genetic material, when enters inside the nucleus of the cell, it will change the characteristic of the host DNA and will produce its own genetic material, that is RNA, and it will multiply. Then it will produce the protein coats or the protective covering separately and RNA separately, and later on this protein coat or the capsid as well as RNA get assembled and form a virus. So in this way they multiply, thus they use the host's DNA, then host's material, and multiply in number. And after multiplication, they will damage this host cell and will infect another cell. So in this way, the infection of virus continues. So viruses can also be called as infectious nucleoprotein particles. That means the nucleic acid shows presence of either DNA or either RNA, and along with this DNA and RNA, they show presence of proteins. Hence, they are also called as, or viruses are also called as, infectious nucleoprotein particles. So here we have seen the characteristics of viruses.